Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Groda, your host for this program. Once again, we have this great opportunity, you and I, to sit back and listen to how the Holy Spirit worked in someone's life. And so unapologetically, when we do the programs, certainly we're going to hear the story tonight of Father Gabriel Landis, but it's also about us. In other words, how do we see the Holy Spirit work in someone's life? And hopefully that helps us recognize, wow, he's been working in my life too. Did I listen? You know, did I respond to the Holy Spirit? And so that's why I always say at the end of the program that I hope this story is an encouragement to you. I mean, that's why Mother Angelica wanted these programs, to be an encouragement to us as we listen to how the Holy Spirit touched someone else's life. That being said, I'm anxious to hear the story tonight. Father Gabriel Landis is a monk at St. Benedict's Abbey in Atchison, Kansas City. He's a former Baptist and a former Lutheran. Father Gabriel, great to have you join us on the program.
Yeah, thank you so much. Appreciate that.
It's really great. I know that you and a group of you kind of were passing through, right?
Yes, yeah. Doing a little traveling. Thank you for inviting us to come on your show.
Well, it's great to have you here. So let me take a step back and invite you to take us way back to the beginning of your journey.
Sure. So I was raised and born in Wichita, Kansas. I have one older brother, and my parents are now deceased. But we were raised in a very devout Baptist household. The Baptist church we went to was not affiliated with any other. It was not Southern Baptist. It was unaffiliated.
But okay.
And as typical, a lot of Protestants are take a lot of things very literally when it comes to the Bible. So I was taught that the world was created in 6 days, and that's open for debate. But other things they took very seriously about, well, the Bible says it this way, it must be this way, except for two things. And it's the Lord's Supper and the baptism. So baptism does not save, is what I was taught. But also when it comes to the Lord's Supper, as Catholics, as a priest, when I confect those words, when I say, this is my body, when I say, this is my blood, what the essence of that bread becomes the body of Christ. The essence of the blood, the wine, becomes the blood of Christ. But when I was Baptist, I remember this one time, I was probably about 8 years old, and I'm sitting next to my dad, and we're having the Lord's Supper, which we had, I think, about once or twice a month. And the pastor is saying the words that I say as a priest. He's saying, this is my body, this is my blood. So I turned to my dad and I pulled on his shirt sleeve and said, "Geez, Dad, is that really Jesus up there?" And my dad said, "No, it's not really Jesus. Why do we do this?" Because he said to, you know. So, but I have to say, kind of in hindsight, I say that it's my Pentecostal moment, because it was one of those rare moments as a young boy who I adored my father. And anytime my dad said something, I always took it seriously. But it's one of the rare times where I did not believe in what my dad would say. And I believe when I say it, in a sense, that was my Pentecostal moment, I believe the Holy Spirit was talking at my heart. And so as I grew older as a Baptist, I was very engaged in my faith.
Would you say, looking back, that during those times you had come to faith in Christ?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's where I came to faith in Christ, as a Baptist. Absolutely. But my heart ached for more, you know. When I was a teenager, I was very active in my youth group. But there's always just certain things that I bothered me as a Baptist. You know, I was taught to believe that once I say the Lord's Prayer, the Jesus Prayer, inviting Christ into my heart, I was taught, okay, you're saved. And you cannot lose that salvation. But it's a lot of that didn't make sense to me. It's like, well, how can that be? How can I live a life that might be displeasing to God and still be saved? So there's a lot of things didn't add up as I started questioning.
I want to interrupt you there a little bit, and I apologize for that. No. But there's something that about that time, as you being brought up in that environment, I kind of wonder if there are some of our audience that have that same question in our mind. Mm-hmm. Those folk that believe once saved, always saved.
Yeah.
Once you say the sinner's prayer, you've saved.
Yeah.
Some of us might think, well, is that therefore that in your church, you didn't spend time about teaching about living a good, holy life since you didn't have to?
Right.
You know, I'm saying that's being a little snarky about it.
Sure.
But But in fact, growing up a Baptist, you believe that.
Yes.
But was there instruction about growing in grace or growing in Christ?
Absolutely. We're taught to believe a Christian will live this type of lifestyle. This is the type of virtues that he'll manifest in his life, which is wonderful. Yet at the same time, there is this nagging thing. It's like, but if I invited Jesus into my heart, I don't necessarily have to live that life. It just didn't add up. There's a lot of confusion going on, which, you know.
I almost say that's another Pentecostal moment.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, the Lord's, there's something not quite right about this.
So, yeah, the Holy Spirit was nagging at me at that, you know. He still nags at me. But so as I grew older, by this time I'm in college. I went to Wichita State University, and I got an undergrad in finance, and I was working at a bank as a teller at that time. I had not finished my degree. And I was talking to another teller who was a Lutheran, Missouri Synod Lutheran. And so we start talking about our faith. And so I told him, look, I'm a Baptist. Baptists believe that Jesus is not present in Lord's Supper. However, I do believe that. And so my friend said, well, why don't you come to my church? I'm a Lutheran. We believe that Jesus is present in Lord's Supper and in Holy Communion. And so I did. And so I took their version of RCIA. I think it lasted maybe 6 to 9 months, you know, being instructed about here's what happened in the Reformation. Here's what Martin Luther taught. Here's sola scriptura, sola fide, sola gratia, all these major principles of Reformation. And so I joined the Lutheran Church basically because Jesus was present, as you know, as Lutherans teach, consubstantiation, you know. Four elements are there as opposed to what we believe is a transubstantiation. So I joined the Lutheran Church.
I was going to say, you also had to kind of get over the barrier of seeing baptism did a little more, too.
Yeah, that's true. The baptism was still bearing fruit.
Yeah.
So I became a Lutheran, and I became one of those pain in the butt type Lutherans, you know?
Is it a specific denomination of Lutherans?
Or? Yeah, it's a subset of Missouri Synod. Yeah. But so I was like gung-ho about my Lutheran faith. And to the point where I would talk to the pastor a few times, and some of the things that he taught bothered me as a Lutheran. So I came to his office a couple of times and said, Pastor, sometimes you say this, X, Y, Z, but Missouri Synod says A, B, C. This is what the Missouri Synod teaches. And he responded to me that something perplexed by another Pentecostal moment. He said, well, I don't always agree with Missouri Synod. Sometimes I'm more ELCA. Sometimes I'm more liberal than Missouri Synod.
Evangelical Lutheran Church
thank
of
you.
America.
Yes.
Yeah, that's right.
And so I was kind of puzzled by that statement. And when I walked away from his office, I was thinking, what branch of Lutheran must I become to find the fullness of truth? And so that kind of put me on a tailspin. And during this time, too, I was being encouraged to become a pastor. You know, they were saying, Doug, you know, you love the faith. Why don't you, you know, quit your job? And by then, I was working at Boeing Aircraft. Why don't you quit your job at Boeing and go join the seminary? And I that scared me so much, along with who do I go to find the fullness of truth, I backed away. And I didn't even discern that at all. And God, since he respects our human freedom, he basically said, okay, if you don't want to discern this, I'm going to let you go. I'm going to respect your freedom. And that led to a period of, you know, not being fulfilled and questioning and things like that. By this time, I'm now working at Boeing Aircraft in Wichita. And
Had that call continued to nag you during that time?
Yeah, I would say so. Yeah, it continued to nag me. I felt like there was something unresolved in my life. Hmm. Again, there was this achiness for the real presence. There was achiness for, I want to know, where do I go to find the truth? Where do I go to find this perfect relationship with Jesus Christ? Hmm. So by then I was working at Boeing and had worked there about 10 years before I left. And when I was working there, I was working with a wonderful girl.
Were you active all in your faith during all the time?
What'd most of the time. I think, as I said, when I felt kind of inclined to discern about becoming a Lutheran pastor, at the same time, I was kind of like, well, what branch of Lutheranism should I become? I kind of backed off from, I did back off from my faith life.
Yeah.
And I, you know, I didn't live a good life at that time, which the Holy Spirit was just leading me on to catch me big time. So I'm working with this wonderful girl named Melissa in a finance department at Boeing, and she's a solid rock Catholic. I mean, she's solid. And so we would talk back and forth during we're working. I would say, I'm a Missouri Synod Lutheran, but I'm unhappy. And she would say, well, I'm a Catholic, and I'm joyful, basically. And I always compare Melissa to that widow in the parable about Jesus is talking about how to pray without ceasing, where there's this widow who is owed a judgment by the unjust judge. And the widow just nags that judge over and over again, give me what's due to me, give me what's due to me. And the unjust judge says, I better give her what she wants, unless she strike me. So finally, Melissa kept on saying, you need to take RCIA. And she was like that woman, just nagged me. She nagged me into the church, basically. So I decided, fine, Melissa, I will take RCIA. I will do it. And she, without even missing a beat, she says, okay, you need to take it at the Newman Center at Wichita State from Father Conley. He is great. So I said, okay, fine. So we go into my first night of RCIA, and I'm like, I'm somewhat convinced maybe this is the right place to be.
Our guest is Father Gabriel Landis. Before you jump into RCIA, I wanted to ask you, you've not mentioned at this point, I don't think, how you felt about the Catholic Church during your Baptist and then Missouri Synod Lutheran perspective.
Wow, that's a great question. I was raised as a Baptist, as you know, and I was told a lot of untrue things about being a Baptist, about being a Catholic. Catholics worship Mary, Catholic pray to statues, Catholic pray to saints, worship saints would be a better word.
Yeah.
Catholics do all these sorts of things. I remember one time talking to my dad outside, we were in the garage, and I was talking to him about our neighbors across the street who were Catholic. And my dad said, they're not Christians, they're Catholics. And again, one of those Pentecostal moments, like, well, that doesn't make sense to me. But yeah, I kind of grew up, you know, in the 60s and 70s, where there's still a lot of strong prejudice against Catholics.
Yeah.
So as I was taking RCIA, I was telling my dad these things, like, Dad, here's what I was taught when I was a boy about the Catholic Church, but that's not necessarily true. Catholics don't worship Mary. They honor her, but yes, you know, and other things. So I would like, okay, Dad, this is what I'm taking. Here's what they say, you know. So even as a Lutheran, I was I left some good friends that did not see eye to eye with me about becoming Catholic. There's a few that understood, and there's a few that I just like, we really respect what you're doing.
One of the struggles I think it was Father Newhouse, who was Missouri Synod before he became Catholic, might have said, is that one of the problems for, especially Lutherans, is you almost have to continue waving the Protestant flag, because as soon as you quit, then it's like, well, then what are we doing here?
Mm-hmm.
So that you have to keep those fires burning.
Yeah.
And that's why I wondered, when you came to the Missouri Lutheran, it seemed to me there were a lot of Missouri Lutherans that were thinking, well, we are Catholics.
Yeah.
It's a little different than the Bed. I'm not sure all Missouris were like that, but a lot of them that we are.
Yeah,
maybe just not united with the Pope over there, but we are.
Yeah. I would say probably the most Missouri synods I was working around with would probably say we are not Catholic.
Okay,
yeah.
Gotcha.
But I understand what you're talking about.
Yeah, okay.
So
you brought that into RCIA. Hey, that's what I want to get at. This is the baggage you were bringing with you.
And the big things I was bringing in was the three solas that I mentioned earlier, especially sola scriptura.
Yeah.
And Father Conley walks in very first night, I can still see this in my head. He's walking in carrying a Bible. And he welcomes us. He says, my name is Father Conley. Tonight, I'm going to use the Bible to show you, and I'm only going to use the Bible to show you why sola scriptura, the Bible alone, is not true. It's not accurate. And so I don't know if I want to go through all the arguments, but...
He knew you were coming, though.
I don't know. I found out later that Father Conley was a convert himself. He's now Bishop of Lincoln, so he's
of course,
very great bishop, very very good Catholic. So he, with 1 hour, he demolished this pillar. And I said, oh, my goodness, I have to become Catholic. Because once you take away that pillar, a sola scriptura, once you see that, you know, Jesus did call Peter, that Jesus did establish a church on earth, using the Bible alone, seeing the connections between the Old Testament and the New Testament, I just went like, wow. I'm sitting in the back row, and I'm going, I have to become Catholic. I took all that energy that I felt as a pain in the behind type Lutheran, modified it. I wasn't a pain in your behind Catholic. But after a few weeks, I told the Lord when I was praying, I said, Lord, I know I should have discerned fuller and deeper when I was Lutheran, that you were calling me, maybe ultimately to lead me to the Catholic Church, but I didn't pray about it. If you want me to be a priest, I'm yours. And I'm here. there's a lot of wonderful things that happened. I joined the church on April 6, 1996, and I had posted something on EWTN's website. I said, my name is Doug Landis. I'm a brand new Catholic. I live in Wichita, Kansas. I love my faith. And I get an email from a monk who I never had met before, never heard from before. He says, welcome to the Catholic Church. My name is Father Meinrad Miller. I'm a monk at St. Benedict's. And that's basically was what it said. And everybody has experiences in life that if we had decided to do something differently, our path of life would have gone off differently. And this is one of those moments where I could have just deleted his email and never would have become a monk. I often tell that when I tell a married couple the story, I said, imagine if you were 15 minutes late from meeting your wife for the first time, you never would have been married to her. Or if you never had the courage to call her up and ask her out for the first or second date, you'd never have been married to this wonderful woman. So I decided to email him, reply back, and that changed my life. I said, Father Meinrad, thank you for your kind email. I have a question. What is a monk? I had no idea what a monk was. And I found out as I was going through this journey that a lot of lay Catholics didn't understand what a monk is. So he replied with three words, come and see. And I found out later he's a vocation director for the Abbey at that time. So called me up.
He used sola scriptura on you because he's just quoting scripture. Come and see.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I'll have to tell him that. That's very good. Yeah. You can use come and see. Lord, where do you live? Come and see.
Come and see.
I came January of 1997. It was the feast day of conversion with St. Paul, which I found kind of ironic. The very first night I got there was the day before the feast day, and I'm thinking, this is really weird. These guys live together, and this is not normal, is what I was thinking. But as I prayed the office with them, the Divine Liturgy, and going to Mass with them, and interacting with them, by that second day, I was going like, you know, this looks kind of neat. You know, I'm gonna have to pray about this. I wasn't totally sold, but I was like, wow, this is kind of cool. They're praying together, and they serve the Lord. When I was working at Boeing, I felt this great emptiness. That I was meant to be doing something differently, and that perhaps this might be fulfilling what my life desire was to be. I made another 3-day retreat in February. another one in March, another one by April. By April, I was thinking, this is what I know I need to do. So I started the process of, you know, putting my house on the market, had a truck and motorcycle I had to get rid of, had a little wire-haired dachshund that I loved a lot, had to find him a home, and everything seemed to, everything worked according to God's timing. It didn't work according to my timing, but it worked to God's timing. And so I joined the monastery as a pre-novitiate. And so I was with them from September to December. And I lived in my street clothes, but I joined them with prayers. That time of period is to help you get used to the idea of becoming a monk, to make sure, in your own sense, yes, God's calling me to become a monk here. And it also gives the opportunity for the community to look at a person and say, do we like this guy or not? Do we really think he's going to be a good fit? Must have thought I was a good fit. So I was accepted into a novitiate on December 7th, 1997. That's when the name I took, Gabriel, and joined the monastery. So, yeah.
And you've been there for how many
26 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Because I was going to say, when the journey home started in 1997, so it's about the same length of time.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So you must have been praying for me. You didn't know it.
There we go. We did. Boy, I've got a lot of questions that I want to ask you in the second half of the program about monastic life. Let's go back. We got about 5 minutes before we want to take a break. I want to go back before you came in. You talk, if you would. Just go back to that sola scriptura issue, for example. Let's go back to that, because you had said that Father
Conley, Bishop Conley,
had nailed you on that.
Yeah.
Rather than going through that whole thing, though, could you remember, for example, since he did it from Scripture, what was one of the key scriptures that he used? If I could ask you this, that he used to demonstrate.
Yeah, I think one that kind of comes to mind is that St. Paul was talking about, he's talking to Timothy, he's telling him, but the scripture you were raised to believe, obviously that could not be referring to the New Testament, because the New Testament had not come about yet. There's that. That's actually, that claims more to the traditions and scriptures that you were raised to believe. There's also the connection that he made between how the Old Testament is fulfilled in the New Testament, and how the office of the keys that David wore something that was known at that time, that a person who accepted the keys of the kingdom had the authority to speak on behalf of that kingdom. So it wasn't just something that Jesus said that I did not notice in growing up as a Protestant. Yep, when he understood the connection between the Old Testament and New Testament, how the office of the keys is fulfilled in Peter, those things were like, wow, this is convincing to me. So
yeah, the scriptures that I used when I was a Presbyterian pastor, and that we assumed that we would preach on and that we would pass on to new members of the church, that we just assumed proclaimed sola scriptura, as you mentioned, came from 2 Timothy chapter 3. But what we often didn't see is 2 Timothy 3:16 is all scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for the training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. And we agree with that 100% as Catholics.
Yeah, absolutely.
But the problem is, all scripture is inspired by God.
Yeah, yes.
Is he referring to this whole thing?
Yes, yeah. How do we know which books of the Bible were meant to be in the book of the Bible? I remember one time when I was at Boeing and I was talking to one of my coworkers about becoming Catholic. He automatically said, he asked, well, why do you Catholics have 7 extra books in the Bible? I replied, why do you have 7 less? And he didn't understand that. So I said, here's what happened. is that actually Martin Luther took those books out of the Bible because he disagreed with some of them. And I didn't know that as a Baptist, as a Lutheran. Well, as a Lutheran, I did that. But most Protestants don't know that this Catholic Bible is the fullness. This is the fullness of Scripture.
Yeah.
And that was discerned through councils and Holy Spirit working.
Yeah, the first edition of the King James Bible in 1611 had all the books.
Wow, I did not know that. Yeah, they okay. Did.
And, you know, I mean, I'm going on memory here, but not that I was there, but that in my own studies, yeah. that, I mean, that would confront yeah. me that yeah. a lot of the early Protestant Bibles had all the books sure. just over time.
Yeah.
But the other thing that you mentioned that I wanted to, before we take a break, is the part that I didn't always see when I looked at these particular verses. And this is what I think, Father Bishop Conley, because yeah. you mentioned it, that we just had that verse. That was 16. But a couple of verses earlier, Paul says, but as for you, Timothy, yeah. continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, mother, and how yeah. from childhood you've been acquainted with yeah, the sacred writings.
Absolutely, yeah.
So here's long before the New Testament's mm-hmm. written. He's been acquainted with the sure. sacred writings.
Yes, yeah.
yeah. So Paul, yeah. what Paul's referring to here is the Old Testament.
Absolutely, yeah.
So even making that jump from this, applying this verse to the whole Bible and not just the Old Testament mm-hmm. requires an authority to say you can do that.
Yes, yes, absolutely. yeah, that's absolutely. That's one thing I that opened up my eyes to the truth of Catholic faith, that there has to be a final authority to say this is it. Otherwise, you're going to have like 70,000 different denominations that all disagree with each other. So,
and we're going to take a break now, but I think one of the first things I also want to ask you when you get back is this issue of authority. How do you decide? Is that you yourself went through this transition of understanding the meaning of the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist. Mm. So who decides
yeah.
which way?
Yes.
Know? And look, when we come back from the break, I want to ask you to talk a little bit more about how for yourself you okay. came to appreciate the beauty of that. But before we take a break, I want to remind you all that if you go to chnetwork.org, that's the website for the Coming Home Network International. Not only when you go there, you can hear more about Father Gabriel Landis and his journey, but you can read lots of other conversion stories and also see the work of the Coming Home Network, what they do to help men like Father Gabriel discover the fullness of the church. Again, that's chnetwork.org. See you in a moment. Welcome back to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grody, your host, and Father Gabriel Landis is our guest. And I mentioned just before the break that we looked at Sola Scriptura. That was one of the pillars that I wanted to kind of throw it back into your onto your court again, a couple of the other pillars that you had to deal with, one of which, as you talked about, was the Eucharist.
Yes.
And you'd had that Pentecostal moment as a young man,
yes.
realizing, well, Dad, you know, that's not... But how did you come in that journey? How would you define the really coming to... I mean, transubstantiation doesn't solve the mystery.
No, it doesn't. I guess I relied on some philosophy, and I'm not quite sure where I picked this up, but St. Thomas Aquinas talked about things being having an essence and having accidents. You know, yeah. This is a cup, so it has cupness. That this is the essence of a cup is that it's able to hold a liquid. It has usually may have a handle or not, but. Yes, but the accidents of something, it describes it. This is a red cup, a coffee cup. It's made out of a certain type of material. And everything in the world, according to St. Thomas, the way he understood things, everything has an essence. Everything has accidents that help describe something.
Yeah.
And they always must agree with each other. As a Protestant, I was taught that, you know, it's not the body of Christ, it's just words that Jesus said. It still remains a little cracker and grape juice is what we used as a Baptist. But this is how we come and understand transubstantiation, is the difference between essence. When I, as a priest, when I'm celebrating Mass, when I say, this is my body, God's working through me, and it still looks like bread, still tastes like bread, still smells like fresh, you know, bread, but, and the accidents have remained the same. Yeah. It's telling me it's bread, but through the mystery that God has given us, that through the, since I'm a priest, laying on of hands, those words make it, change it something different. It changes the essence from being bread into being the essence of the body of Christ. Same thing applies when I'm doing the blood of Christ. So that's kind of help me understand how it becomes. I don't remember what that was. If I learned that part during my RCIA or a little bit afterwards. But that was probably the biggest thing right there, was trying to understand what St. John, what Thomas Aquinas had said about it. And also something else too, as I discovered, as a Protestant, as a Baptist, John chapter 6 was never discussed.
Yeah.
Never, never, ever was that discussed in my presence that I recall. And that's sad. Because when as a Catholic, when we read that scripture, we see Jesus say, and he means it. There is no running away. When he says, you must eat my flesh and drink my blood, he is serious. Mm-hmm. He's not talking in some type of hypothetical way. The language is quite clear. And when people, you know, it says, and many of his disciples who had been with him a long time became troubled at these words, they left him. Yeah. And because they totally understand that he's literally meaning, you must literally eat my flesh and literally drink my blood. And that, the proof from scripture, so right there, was like, oh, wow, that's pretty amazing. And then when he turns to Peter and says, what about you guys? What will you do? And that's something that has reinforced my belief as a Catholic, even if I might have had difficult times at times. No, we're staying with you. Where else would we go? For you have the words of eternal life. And so right for scripture right there was the major thing. So there's a balance of how St. Thomas Aquinas explains things, but also John chapter 6 really proved.
I can't help, as I listen to you, think about who I might be envisioning could potentially be watching us, because coming from a background similar to yours, when we hear some transubstantiation and we see the philosophical ideas, it just could be gobbledygook.
Yes, you're right.
But what helped me was Newman's statement, to become deep in history is to cease to be Protestant.
Yeah.
And that helps me understand that if you really want to understand transubstantiation, you need to understand the history that led the church to recognize this is the best way that we humans can understand this mystery. Because the history simply is that our Lord, we have the scriptures and we have what our Lord said, and it isn't easy. John 6 isn't easy.
Yes.
How do we understand that? So the early church fathers basically said, listen, don't trust your senses. Jesus said it. This is my body.
Yeah.
And that was good for a long time.
Yes, centuries. Yes. Yeah.
To 1,000 years. We left it as a mystery until a guy by the name of Berengarius started challenging it around the year 1000. And so we have, all of a sudden, we get into a battle of words. And so the church, of all the different opinions, had to come down to, how do we protect the mystery? And that's all transubstantiation tries to do. We recognize it's beyond us.
Yes.
But it helps us understand the mystery of it. And so the problem is sometimes the battle gets us away from our focus, away from the very thing that's important, which is the mystery of Jesus being there, body and blood, soul and divinity.
Yeah. Yes. It's going back to that Pentecostal moment. Jesus said it, so it must be true. Yeah. I don't understand it. Yeah. My senses might say one thing, but my faith in Jesus Christ tells me the truth.
Yeah. I think that, I mean, let's face it, there's an awful lot of people in the world that would not understand this philosophical category.
Yeah.
But at the core of their faith is Jesus said it.
Yes.
I will believe it to be true. Absolutely. Luther himself said that, but he was caught up in those battles. Mm-hmm. But he himself said that, this is my body. He yelled and against the other Protestants, including those Baptists, that didn't want to go with it at all.
Sure.
This is my body. Yeah. So he was trying to hold on to that mystery. Another of the pillars that that you referred to back there, and that is this issue of faith alone as a pillar, because you also recognize that as a Baptist, you're growing up, wait a second here. You know, once saved, always saved. Does that mean I don't have to live my life? Well, that one pillar kind of emphasized it's faith alone.
Yes.
Talk about coming to the Catholic way of understanding that.
Well, there it's worse. St. James is wonderful about that. He says, don't be just listeners of the word, be doers of the word as well. You know, if you say you're saved because what you believe, but not what you do, I got news for you, buddy. That's not good. So that really kind of shaped me too, because I understand that it's not faith alone that saves us. It is what we do with that faith that God's given us. So if I'm not living a life of love, I'm just an empty gong, I'm an empty symbol. I have to live out that faith that shows that I'm following Jesus Christ. So that was pretty much, I think St. James was probably the one that really opened up my eyes. And again, as a Protestant, as a Baptist, I don't recall that being spoken about a lot. He didn't write the gospel, so he's back here. And Martin Luther didn't have much good to say things about St. James. He called it the Epistle of Straw. What I love about the Catholic view of Scripture, it's so interconnected that you can't take out one book without harming the wholeness of it. So that was probably the biggest thing to me is what St. James talked about, other with the church fathers taught about it, was that it's not just faith alone.
That struggle with that, with the both and of faith and works, is a both and there. It's not an either or.
No.
And trying to keep that balance.
Yeah, you're right. Because I've found that same thing. Scott Hahn talks about that. It's not just, it can be either or. It's both and. And that's what I love about being Catholic. There's a lot of times when it comes up, it's not either or, it's both and.
If you take the either, the both and, faith and works, as James talks about, and if you start interpreting that as somehow earning my salvation, then you've immediately gone back into the either or, because you've said it's either me or God. There's a both and in there. There's always that partnership between grace and our free will. And there's the mystery.
Absolutely. You know,
God's sovereignty and yet our total freedom. There's a both and in there. And so now we're again stuck with the mystery.
Absolutely.
Now we've just talked about faith and works and the Eucharist and the meaning of baptism we talked earlier. How has escaping from the world... into a brown, black robe into this little community. How has that helped you grow and accomplish faith and works and the Eucharist and, you know, to live that out?
Sure. I understood early.
And I'm being snarky about
that. That's okay. I might be snarky. But I understood that when I was making the visits and being interviewed by the monks as I was making my petition to join, I remember seeing the Father Blaine. I understand that coming here, it's by living with the monks who are most difficult, that's how I'm going to be made to a saint. That I understood it's not because of some of these guys I really like and I get along easy with. No, that's not how God works. He wants to rub away the rough edges of my life. So living in a community and trying to love my brothers, even the ones that really kind of grate on my nerves, and I'm sure I grate on people's nerves as well, I'm there for an instrument of your salvation. But it's living a community, living a life of charity towards one another. That's how God has called me to live out my life. I don't even say I even briefly discern being a diocesan priest or regular priest. Most diocesan priests, they're going to live alone, or they do live with another priest. Usually they're not in communication a lot. They're so busy. I felt that would be wrong for me in my prayer life. I felt this is not good. And I did do some years as a monk, as a priest in parishes, but ultimately I was, you know, I love living in along my brothers, among my brothers, because those ones that I drive crazy or they're crazy, God is working me through patience. When I pray for patience, God says, okay, I'm going to give it to you straight. He would just like, okay, he poured it on. So I love my brothers. I've been a monk since 1997. Is the first best thing in my life was becoming Catholic. The second best thing in my life was becoming a monk and a priest. I don't know what to say about that besides they became...
Well, is this true? Let me ask you this. That it seems that Catholic spiritual writers like John of the Cross or Teresa of Avila or Gregory Lagrange or Father Dubé, if you took their writings, it seems that they summarize the spiritual life that we're to go through, Bonaventure talking about Journey of the Mind to God, that there seems to be at least two, if not three, major stages. At least one stage is, the first stage is we clean up the mess on the outside.
Yeah.
You know, that we're, and that's what people see. It's more obvious. It's cleaning up the mess. But then you get to the really difficult part, and that's cleaning up the mess that's in here.
Mm.
And the more it gets, it's almost more important. The clean up the outside, we got to do that. And there's some bad habits, but grace enables us to do that. And then we're able to really deal with on the inside. And of course, they also talk about a third, you know, deeper one. But it almost seems to me that one of the problems we have out here is that we can deal with the outsides, but we can get away with thinking we've arrived.
Yes.
But when you're in a monastery with a bunch of people is when you really deal with that deeper stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
Would you say that's kind of what happened?
Oh, gosh, I'd say that's true. I think you're almost forced, in a sense, to go deeper and look into your interior life. Instead of me being angry at a particular monk, if he's upset me or whatever, I have to understand why that upset me. And to understand, okay, what wound did he touch interiorly? Why am I responding in patience or lack of charity with this guy? So it's always focused inwardly in a healthy way that God is saying, don't worry about what Brother Xavier did to you.
Yeah.
That's his fault. You can't change him. You must change in here. You must change your interior life to be more docile. And much more patient, much more kinder, and much quicker to forgive. Living in community, living as a monk, is just a deeper call to prayer, a deeper call relationship with Jesus Christ. So you're right, we clean up what's on outside, but living in a monastery forces you to really deal with what's going on inside.
And we would say that it's not that those of us outside the monastery can escape it, because that's also why God gave us family.
Absolutely. Yeah,
that's why God gave us marriage. Yeah. God gave us family, because on the outside world we can look pretty good, but in the family we are who we are. And by grace we then, in the same way, can learn to deal with our problems, because we can't escape our spouse or our children or fake them.
Yeah, yeah,
because they really know us.
Oh yeah, so that's wonderful about the sacrament of reconciliation. You hear a lot about, you know, blessing Father, I've sinned. I got upset with my wife today. I yelled at my kids, and I'll give them some easy penance, and say, but remember, you are called to be called to the sacrament. Remember that when you took your vows when you got married, you said, I will lay down my life for my family. So, but we never fully live up to that, to those vows. I think because we're always in need of sin, but it's just a wonderful way for us to recognize that God's calling us to holiness in whatever vocation that we have. I triggered something on you.
In fact, there's a verse here about husbands. It applies to husbands, and I wonder if it also applies to living in community.
Okay.
First Peter 3 says, likewise, you husbands, Live considerately with your wives, bestowing honor on the woman as the weaker sex, since you are joint heirs of the grace of life, in order that your prayers may not be hindered. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
yeah. Is that if we're not living together, our prayer life.
Yes. That's another wonderful thing about being a monk is that our prayer life, we're not as called to pray about it. We're not there just to save our own souls, to have God work on us. We're there to pray for the body of Christ. So I'm there to pray for you in ways that I never even knew I was praying for you. Monks are there to pray and intercede and lay down their life, perhaps in a kind of a white martyr type way, to lay down a life for the good of the world. That's something that I didn't realize until maybe a few years to my monastic life, this understanding that I might not ever die as a martyr, as a red martyr, but I am called to lay down my life, not only for my brothers, the way I live out my life, and I don't do it perfectly, but I'm called as a husband, in a sense, to the whole world, because I am married to the body of Christ.
And if you're having an ongoing battle with Brother Xavier over there, but yet you get together in your prayer life, that prayer life is hindered.
Yes, yeah.
Unless you leave your gift at the altar and deal with...
Yeah, go reconcile.
Yeah, you can't escape that in a monastery.
No, yeah. No. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. It's hard, and I've seen that, you know, before, whether myself been doing it, or I see that monks might have a hard time, maybe not forgiving one another, and seeing how that does affect their own life and how it affects the life of the monastery.
Yeah.
So I'm guilty of that too.
Well, so, you know, mea culpa.
Mea culpa. That's right.
Let's take this email. Aaron from New Mexico. I am Methodist, but have recently become interested in Liturgy of the Hours. They seem complicated, but I'm sure once you get the hang of them, they're a lot easier to follow. I just don't know where to start. Do you have any tips for beginners who want to get started with these ancient prayers?
Sure. Okay. Well, you know, I hate to quote the president's co-speaker, but Google it. But yeah, there's some other wonderful websites. I would suggest buying the 4-volume set. They're a little pricey, but buying the 4-volume set of Liturgy of the Hours. And they usually have a guide with it that can help you set up the prayers. I would recommend to start out maybe just saying the morning prayer and an evening prayer as part of your life. Because what I love about being a monk is that we pray the prayers that Jesus prayed when he was a little boy, as he was growing up to be an adult. Yeah. And he had these wonderful ways to, I've seen maybe a few lines out of a verse. You know, I don't know, so I'm going sidetracked. But I think that would probably be the best ways to, and then also if you can see a monastery that's close to you, come visit us in Atchison, Kansas. We do invite people to come pray with us to make retreats. So I would say that would be a good start. If you can get the 4-volume set and also check out monasteries, go to some good Catholic websites that have that on there. Mm-hmm. I was a little intimidated when I was shown as I had not joined the Catholic, I had not joined the monastery yet, but someone showed me the 1-volume set.
And the Christian prayer.
Yeah, and there was a lot of going back and forth, which kind of went over my head.
Yeah.
So if I think it's easier to get the 4-volume set and just use that.
I hate to mention, but I've got to mention that, of course, today with iPhones and all that, you can get an app that walks you right through it. The reason I hate to say it is I hate to leave the paper. You know, I prefer the the paper and holding it. And so, but if you have a chance to visit a monastery so you can at least
see how
they do that really, really helps. Sure. You know, where to put your ribbons and
absolutely
and walk your way through. It takes a while. Be patient with yourself. And of course, a local priest
deacon. Yes, that's right, absolutely right. A priest prays it on his own. So, you know, if you are a Catholic and want to learn how to pray it, ask your local pastor to do that. Okay. Help you do that.
All right, let's take another email. Ethan from Georgia. I'm starting to wonder if I might be called to a priestly vocation, but I'm not sure whether I should talk to the diocese or consider looking into a religious order instead. What led you to follow your call to the priesthood in the Benedictine order specifically?
kind of go back to earlier what I said. I felt when I was taking RCIA, I told God, I'm totally yours if you want me to be a priest. So there was that. I think you just have to trust the Holy Spirit to lead you to the right places. That doesn't mean you don't do any work. You do need to do your own work. I would contact your archdiocese and talk to vocation visitors. Start making visits to different religious communities. You need to start putting your name out there in a sense, just like, tell me about what's good about your community. Talk to vocation director, archdiocese. Start going to their vocation retreats. The Holy Spirit will tell you if you are open to following Him. He will tell you and show you where you need to go. Yeah. But yeah, that's a pretty good question, though.
I'm guessing there are folk out there that see the different communities, and on the outside, it's like, well, what's the difference between the Franciscans and the Dominicans mm-hmm. and the Benedictines and the Trappists?
Sure.
And the, you know, how would I even start? Because it could be a little, what would you say would be the unique thing that you would point out from a Benedictine standpoint compared to the other?
Well, I take a vow of stability, which is different from any other religious community. I will never be transferred from one house to another. I'm always will be a monk, St. Benedict's Abbey. We have a cemetery, and I know pretty approximately where I will be buried. So that's one thing about monks. We have this take a vow of stability. We also take a lifetime vow of conversion, basically, that I know that that God's not finished with me yet, that I will always go through a conversion. My conversion didn't stop when I joined the Catholic Church. God's always yeah. going to take me. That I think those are two differences right there. It's about stability, because I'm always going to be formed by my community. I'm always going to be formed with Brother Xavier for the next 20 to 30 years of my remaining life. And that's the beauty I see in monastic life. I'm going to be around these guys. Other religious orders, like the Dominicans or other ones, they may say, we're transferring you to go serve in this particular ministry field. So you can be transferred and not have those lifelong relationships like I have.
Yeah, so part of it's not that so much that that's bad, but knowing yourself, where God's
exactly.
calling you to be.
Yeah, yeah. If you're called to be a Dominican, then go to our earlier question. You need to go fill that. If God's calling you to become Dominican or Franciscan or Benedictine. Yeah. So God's going to fill your needs. He's going to fulfill your desires.
It seems that, I wanted to ask you about Our Lady. Mm. We got like 2 minutes, you know, because that was a journey from Baptist to
yeah.
Catholic Church.
Yes, yeah. Oh, sure. It's an amazing thing. I think I didn't have a hard time accepting Our Lady I think maybe that's why I took the kind of detour from being a Protestant, a Baptist, to being a Lutheran. I think by becoming Lutheran, I was more enriched by the liturgy that Missouri Synod Lutheran Church has. And then by the time I was looking to become a Catholic and talking with Melissa for 2 years before I started taking RCIA, I think it really accepting Our Lady was not that big of an issue for me as opposed to a lot of Protestants. I love Our Lady. I have a particular devotion to Our Lady of Sorrows is my favorite. I just think she speaks to us so much strongly in that.
I almost wonder if our non-Catholic brothers and sisters who don't understand much about monastic life would also think it's strange that a whole bunch of men gather together have a devotion to Our Lady.
Yeah. yes, absolutely right. That's one of the puzzlements about monastic life. Each one of us have a particular way of living out that life, our adoration to our devotion to Mary.
Yeah, so, well, yeah. It's one of those ways of recognizing we're not alone. We have men and women who are our brothers and sisters mm-hmm. who are praying for us, interceding for us. That's a big family. That's the communion of
Absolutely.
Saints.
Absolutely.
That's another big characteristic of of our faith that might be different from our separated brethren.
Yes.
Father Gabriel, thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Marcus.
For joining us on the program, sharing your journey. I do want to tell the audience that there's a website called kansasmonks.org.
That is correct. Yes.
If they go there, they can find out more about
Absolutely.
Your life.
Yeah. And yeah, please come out and visit us. We love visitors. And I think Benedict wrote in his rule that he said, monasteries are never without visitors. So anytime you come visit with us as well, Marcus, you're most welcome.
Thank you, Father Gabriel. Thank you for joining us on this episode of The Journey Home. I do pray that Father Gabriel's journey is an encouragement to you. See you next week.